help you guys our presentation.
And tomorrow, what do we got on tap, guys? What is tomorrow? Somebody want to share? What are yours tomorrow? Maya, what are you doing?
Black Lives Matter and
Impressive, all lives matter.
All right. What else are we doing tomorrow? Christina, what are you doing?
Islamophobia.
Islamophobia certainly seems to be a good topic of the day. And the third one, what's
political
the
correctness.
Political correctness. All right. So those are all of our topics.
Safe space?
No.
So?
So, good morning. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Alan Carvajal. And I'm Eric Young. Now, I'm sure most of you have been following the recent events in France, whether it is on the news or on social media. So, by show of hands, how many of you are familiar with Facebook's new French flag filters? How about the hashtag Pray for Paris? Well, this has aroused a lot of discussion among people. For example, is it always sincere, or does it bring about any real change? Furthermore, why isn't there a Lebanese flag filter, or a hashtag Pray for Beirut? Why isn't there a Syrian flag filter, or a hashtag Pray for Baghdad? Why isn't there a flag filter for the European Union? Because underlying these horrific events that have transpired in France is another issue that is still today a very relevant problem in our world, and that is the European refugee crisis. Now, we're not here to criticize those of you who choose to keep Paris in their thoughts, but we're here to encourage you to make you think, to encourage you to think more critically about the things you choose to actively support and why. And more specifically, we'd like you to think about what is our duty as human beings to those affected by the European refugee crisis. We're sure that many of you have seen pictures like this before. Unfortunately, this European refugee crisis, described as a human wave washing over Europe's southern shore, has led up to humans literally washing up on Europe's shores. Pictures like this began to circulate just this past summer, but this migration has been going on for several years. 2015 is the worst year to date, and the situation only seems to be getting worse. To give you an idea of the severity of the situation, we are witnessing the largest influx of migrants since the end of World War II. Thousands, hundreds of thousands of migrants from all over Africa and the Middle East have entered Europe, while millions more are on their way via Turkey, Lebanon, and Jordan. Now, the largest proportion of migrants have come from Syria. Since March of 2011, more than 4 million Syrians have left their country, making up more than half of all migrants this year. As many of you know, Syria is a country ravaged by civil war. Bombings and violence, like those witnessed in Paris, are a daily threat to civilians who are often caught between the forces of President Bashar al-Assad, his opposition and militant rebel groups, and the religious extremists of ISIS. To date, there have been hundreds of thousands of deaths in this conflict, while millions more are ill, malnourished, abused, or exploited. In addition, millions of children have been forced to prematurely end their academic careers. So evidently, the situation is not optimal in Syria. However, many Europeans refuse to believe that some of these migrants have a valid reason for leaving their country. A common misconception held even by European leaders is that the majority of migrants are in fact economic migrants, meaning that they're just looking for a better life. And this term has a negative connotation among Europeans because it means that they don't really have a good reason to leave their country and cause havoc in Europe. However, the reality is that the majority of migrants are in fact political refugees, meaning that they face a daily threat of violence and persecution. Unfortunately, widespread resentment of economic migrants erodes support for political refugees. Currently, the general European attitude towards migrants is very unwelcoming. Much of Europe is not prepared, physically or mentally, to take in such a large influx of refugees. Europe has the opportunity to come together to solve this problem, but the disjointed policies of its constituents only aggravate the situation. Tensions have been rising steadily because of the disproportionate burden faced by some countries, such as Germany, Turkey, and Greece. European nations need to figure out a way to physically deal with this mass migration and change the current attitude towards refugees. But we in America may ask the question, why do we care about what's going on in Europe? Please bear this question in mind as we continue our presentation. Individual European governments certainly bear some logistical concerns regarding refugees.
How should they decide who is allowed in and who isn't? Where will migrants stay while awaiting a decision regarding asylum? Is it even economically feasible to take in such an enormous number of refugees? Economic concerns are especially prevalent among Europeans. A common concern is that migrants will take away jobs from the native population because they are willing to work for less money. In addition, people believe that lazy migrants will take advantage of Europe's generous benefits systems. Unemployed, non-taxpaying migrants will only increase the burden on taxpaying Europeans. Furthermore, most Europeans are opposed to increased spending by governments, which is necessary to accommodate such a large influx of migrants. For example, Germany plans on spending $6.6 billion to accommodate 800,000 refugees it expects by 2016.
Now, these are all relevant, important logistical concerns, but at its root, this is a humanitarian crisis. And as human beings, we should be more concerned about those directly involved. Currently in Europe, the state of affairs is one of volatility, unpredictability, and confusion, leaving Europeans unsure of exactly what to do or how to act. But for the refugees, it's much worse as they have found their new lives difficult. For example, they found that the standard of living is not necessarily much better than it was in their own countries. Many European countries, with the help of the UN and various charity organizations, have been forced to set up refugee camps to hold all this vast number of refugees. And that's great, but unfortunately, they don't always offer an ideal quality of life. They're often undersupplied and overcrowded, subjecting refugees to the cold, hunger, and disease. And this is bound to get worse as we approach the winter. In addition, it is extremely difficult for refugees to get jobs, especially because it takes an inordinate amount of time to achieve asylum status. Basically, what happens when migrants enter a country is they get a form that says you're allowed to return to register for asylum by this date. And this amount of time can be anywhere from a few months to several years, during which time the refugees are not allowed to work. So how are they supposed to support themselves and their families? The refugee camps help a little bit with food and supplies, but it's definitely not enough for self-sustenance. And one might argue that this quality of life is marginally better than what they're used to in their own countries, but it is still no way to live.
To make matters worse, refugees face intense discrimination based on race and religion. Discrimination is prevalent even in the most welcoming countries, such as Germany. In Germany, in 2015 alone, there have been more than 340 attacks on refugee camps, including acts of vandalism, hate speech, arson, and physical assaults. According to reports, most of these attacks stemmed from radical anti-immigration sentiment, but many have been fueled by Islamophobia as well. Even before the terrorist attacks in Paris, people feared that ISIS operatives might pose as Syrian refugees in order to infiltrate the EU to carry out their horrible missions. Now it seems that some of these fears are in fact rational. But while mostly Muslim, the vast majority of the refugees are not terrorists, and it is unfair for them to be treated as such. The reality is that the terrorists who committed these terrible acts are the very people that the refugees are fleeing from. However, most Europeans fail to see the distinction between Islam and terrorism.
So, a recent Fox News clip showed a segment of this video. I'll show it real quick.
Video surfaces online showing why some are worried Europe is opening its doors to potential terrorists. Those are reportedly Muslim refugees on a train in Europe chanting Allah Akbar or God is great. Now, to be clear, we're not saying that any of those people are terrorists or in any way affiliated with a terror group, but it does highlight just how many of these refugees who are fleeing violence in Iraq and Syria are Muslim.
So, obviously, this is a very clear display of discrimination in America, but in Europe, it's much worse as it is confrontational, to the refugees. Discrimination operates on all levels. It affects everything from refugees' interactions on the street to their abilities to get jobs. it even operates on a national level. For example, a survey declared that due to a lack of mosques, it would only take in Christian refugees, leaving all other refugees in the cold. That being said, there are some reasons to be optimistic about the situation. For example, Turkey has shown that there can be economic benefits to taking in such a number of refugees. For example, many of the migrants that have entered Turkey within the past couple years actually have professional careers, including like doctors, architects, and engineers. And so this has caused some displacement of Turkish workers, but what these workers have done is go back to school and then come back and get better jobs. So this influx of migrants has actually indirectly caused an increase in the average wages for Turkish workers. In addition, many of the Syrians that have entered Turkey have come in with prior assets, and they've made investments in the economy. In 2014, over a quarter of all Turkish businesses claim to have had Syrian ownership or capital.
Also, Germany has shown that it is possible to change a nation's attitude. Why is Germany taking in the most refugees among all the EU nations? Does Germany foresee the potential economic benefits of letting in refugees? Clearly, they do. Germany's birth rate has collapsed to the lowest level in the world, and its workforce will start to plunge at an even faster rate than Japan's by the early 2020s, seriously threatening the long-term viability of Europe's leading economy. So Germany counts on migrants to replenish its aging workforce. It has been concluded that, in most countries, migrants pay more in taxes and social contributions than they receive. This is partly because most migrants are young and need relatively little in the way of benefits. More or less, most of the countries within the EU are threatened by aging populations. So why not look at refugees as fresh labor force and new economic stimulators? If people abandon the one-sided portrayal of immigrants as economic leeches, but rather rationally analyze the potential economic benefits of this refugee crisis, this will no longer be a crisis, but a golden opportunity to reinvigorate our economy. And so now, we in America, what can we in America learn from the way Europe has dealt with the refugee crisis? At this point in time, migration in Europe still remains a divisive issue. The disjointed policies of the EU members have proven to be grossly ineffective. Although America is not in the center of this refugee crisis, but we have to deal with the immigrants on a daily basis. And if we face a crisis of this magnitude in the future, it is important that we are unified in our stance as a more welcoming society towards immigrants. But this fundamental American value is threatened by, as some American politicians, such as Donald Trump, propose to build a giant wall on the US border with Mexico. And nativism and Islamophobia started to rise again in the recent years, as we frequently hear about immigrants' horrible experiences here. As the leader of the free world, it is important that we take a more prominent role in the European refugee crisis by solidifying our welcoming attitude towards migrants, and at the same time urging Europe to take a more active role in helping refugees.
So why should we care about Europe's migrants? Because really, you're no different from them. My parents immigrated to this country, and at some point, your ancestors probably immigrated here as well. And the fact is, America is a nation of immigrants, and it is immigrants that have worked hard to bring prosperity to America today. An example of this is Marco Rubio, who one might argue gets some of his popularity from this principle. He and his parents embodied the American dream. They overcame hardship to come to America for a better life. And that's something we have to appreciate. And also, we have to see that as an inalienable right. It is no different in Europe. For now, the attacks in Paris have highlighted this issue, but it will surely become less sensational over time, as people just tend to lose interest in these sorts of issues, because new tragedies and crises come up every week. But it is our duty to not lose interest.
As more countries close their borders, more young Syrians will surely join the ranks of ISIS. Every time a refugee is denied, he or she is turned over to ISIS. Every time a wall is built, we prove that democracy is exclusive to those born in Western civilizations. We can never contain ISIS or restore peace in Middle East until we recognize the significance of helping refugees and making our homes theirs as well. The power of humanity is stronger than any weapon because it governs people's souls.
So we can let our decisions be ruled by reluctance and fear, or we can act with humanity and reason. What do we want our legacy to be? Do we want to be remembered as people who are selfish and indignant and just watch people suffer? Or do we want to be remembered as the people who care? It's up to us. And maybe it takes a little more than simply spreading the word through social media activism, but each and every one of us has the ability to make a change for the better in this world by supporting the refugees of Europe. Thank you.
Thank you.
What do we do in America for our current crisis?
I think given sort of our more separate borders and the necessity of having migrants travel on planes or whatever, we have a multi-layered security system for immigration here, I think it makes more sense for us to take in a small amount of refugees. It's a little disheartening to see what some governors have done.
Yeah, 30 have said what?
Right.
30 governors have just said this week.
We don't actually have that power technically, but it's symbolic.
But what are they saying?
It's symbolic that won't take any.
Yeah. So what did Obama say a few weeks ago before what happened in Paris? That we have an obligation to take 10,000 Syrian refugees. What's the difference between a refugee and an immigrant? I don't know. They're different language. What's the difference?
I think it's that an immigrant is guided by sort of like intrinsic purposes, whereas a refugee is fleeing from something.
Yes. And that we have a right and need and an obligation to keep them safe. 10,000 Syrians are allowed to come into the United States. Obama said that's what we need to do. What are some other folks saying this week after what happened in Paris? What are they saying?
I think a lot of people now have the conception that the taking of refugees would be a threat to national security.
Yep. Yep.
A lot of people are saying that we should go back on that.
Yep.
And Obama's sticking by his word and saying, we should still do this, our responsibility. And they say, since America was founded on immigration, or people who are, because America was founded on people fleeing their home situation to come to a better life. So.
Agree or disagree? It's respect or dare. Can you look what happened in Paris? Somebody got through as a refugee, and he was one of the leaders, who ate, and they've blown up a lot of people, and we caused a lot of mayhem. Can we protect America from the possibility that one of these 10,000 people could be, an ISIS person, and therefore we have to protect ourselves.
It's definitely scary to think about the possibility that somebody entering our country is a threat to our country.
So should we shut the borders for that? With this current sort of ISIS range? What do you think? Ms. Blair.
Well, I have to go, but great job, gentlemen. I don't know what I think. I would like to help refugees, but I think we have so many issues in our own country, and our own people, citizens, are struggling. I would like us to support people here to get our house together before we reach out to others. And there's this fear, like you said, it could be one person out of 10,000 could blow something up. So the fear, we're letting people in. I'm scared for the refugees that we let in about the prejudice, about how they're going to be treated too. So I'm sort of in the middle. I want to help others, but I would like us to help ourselves first.
So World War II, the folks called the Jews in Germany, who wanted to bring this country as,
I saw this article.
Good, they're vegan.
I don't remember who published it.
Washington Post.
Yeah, the Washington Post. And it was like a clip from a newspaper in 19. There was one from 1938, and then there was one again from like 1942. And it said like how many people would be what percent of Americans would be unwilling to take in Jewish refugees from Germany and Austria. And less than 5% said they'd be willing to take the Jews in, and over 67% said that they're completely unwilling to let anyone in. And those numbers, like, that was even before the events of, like, Kristallnacht or anything had started. And then after that had actually happened and the Jews did start getting sent to these concentration camps, those numbers stayed the same, like, no more, or, like, maybe they increased by, like, a couple percent, but, like, the vast, vast majority of Americans said that they were not willing to take any Jews into.
Should we take them in?
I think so. I mean, I think so.
Oh, but that's a security issue.
There are plenty of people in America currently who could blow up
just
as easily.
So true.
I mean, assuming that a refugee or an Islamic person or a Syrian or have any larger risk of blowing things up is just straight up racist.
Yeah. Straight up racist. Yeah.
If you think about it as if America's a private school. And so you let in select people and stuff like that. How can you assume that you're letting in, know that you're letting in someone who will go and shoot up the school? So, like, you don't know, you're just letting in people into your school, so why are you, like, letting in some people and not others?
So you're arguing that...
That, like, you should let in the refugees. That not you, like, America should let in the refugees. Because there's no way that you can actually know.
But you see, this is such a special issue, right? And, you know, we're really flaming the Republicans are really flaming the fire this week, right? Like, we need to stay safe. It really does sort of feed into our own sort of paranoia.
Yeah, I was going to say that when Mr. Blair said he was kind of, like, on the fence about it in the middle, it kind of made me think about immunized presumption, because I don't think it is something that you can be on the fence about. Like, you either, if you believe in protecting our own security, you are against the refugees, and, like, you can't really say that you agree with one without, you know, the aftermath of the other one, too. So I think that's why it makes it so difficult. So.
Yeah, I just want to say I completely disagree with what Ben said. First of all, if there are a number of homegrown terrorists in this country already, that's a set number, right? So adding more immigrants with potential to be terrorists only increases the amount of attacks in your country. You can't just say, because some in the country could commit violence now, why don't we just let anyone in? And secondly, it's not racist at all. It's a fact that Muslims, on a disproportionate basis, are more likely to be terrorists just because the extremist portion of that religion is higher than other religions. And people coming from Syria, which currently has the sort of largest terrorist group and most threatening terrorist group in the world, right, have a much higher potential of infiltrating this country and perpetrating attacks like what we saw in Paris. And I'm all for compassion, but unless you can be sure that someone isn't going to commit an attack, I don't know how you can put American lives in jeopardy.
We need to cut this off by 10 or whatever couple times to get organized so that we can have Jesse go. A couple of things, and I have a few statistics to just mess everybody up, which is my job in life.
Yeah. Well, okay, I mean, I don't want to, like, run all over this, your presentation. Your presentation is, like, a lot about this, but, like, the religion of Islam itself does not promote violence. It's individuals who are violent. So, like, that's just a, and, like, I agree that people who, like, a large percent of people who are living in Syria right now, as opposed to the rest of the world, are terrorists. Just
not a large percent.
Because ISIS is in Syria, not because it's a Muslim country, but I think that it is racist to say we're not going to let anyone from this religion in just because there's a higher percentage that any individual from this religion is a terrorist, which I actually don't agree with, but, like, I think that is a racist statement, and I think that, again, this nation was founded on immigration, and so...
I didn't say all Muslims were terrorists, but
I know you didn't say all immigrants, but you're saying.
No, but they.
One at a time. Nick.
I think at the same time we have to recognize that although it may be considered racist to just say that people from the Middle East are. Be terrorists and we can't let them in, we have to recognize that where we have Islamophobia, they have American phobia because of what we've done in their countries, in that area, over the last few years, and they do have a natural distrust, and they are fed propaganda through ISIS and other terrorist groups that we are the enemy. And although there are thousands of people who look at that and see through it and say,
how about hundreds of thousands?
Hundreds of thousands.
Right, that's, it's not just like, I mean, proportionally the number of Syrian refugees that have left and gone to Europe versus the number of terrorists. I'm an English teacher, not a math person, is so statistically low. I think we just need to be clear on that, right? It's not like there's an abundance of people that are in anywhere to their speak. I mean, you guys chime in too here. But it's just, I just think we need to use our language well. Okay.
But at the same time, I think that where they wouldn't willingly allow more and more American soldiers to come in, it's hard for us to say that if these people, even if they believe that America's a great country, they have been fed that propaganda, so I think it's
let me give you another scenario really quickly. Let's go back. You guys can't remember, but Ms. Maddock and I can. 2001 after 2011 after 9/11 shut down our borders. How many refugees have come into the United States since 9/11? Give me a number. Anybody have any idea? How many refugees around the world? 50 is not the right number. How about 750,000 refugees have come in post-9/11? Entered this country legally. The refugees also to, I think Amy said, right, they're not immigrants necessarily. They're here to flee sort of world, you know, crisis, right? How many have been arrested in from that 750,000 trapped refugees? One of the issues that we can do in America that they're not able to do in Europe is they're tracking the refugees. Like, if you come here illegally, we can track you in America, so there is a little more safety. How many have been arrested, do you think, or even consider to be terrorist threats to our country? Post 50? Number? You think a lot? What percent of the 750,000 refugees? About two. Two people have been arrested for terrorist possibility on the 750,000 who come here legally. And that was the same paranoia that we had. Right?
No, just
post 9/11. I'm just throwing out statistics. And then we have more talks for you that have nothing to be, I don't think, as heated, thank God.
Oh my God.
That is no percent.
0.00.
Yeah. And it's just, you know, and this is for the speed of all you guys. Lucy, right? Lucy? And then we're shopping and moving on. You can come back tomorrow. We can.
I just like also want to say that the people did the acts of terrorism in Paris, they weren't refugees. They were people taking advantage of the situation.
One came through in the refugee situation.
Came with the refugees. They weren't
refugees.
Right.
One came.
Okay, so just want to get your little brains thinking. All right, and as you vote, if you guys had come the other day to Amy's, right, and are you guys ready? You guys are going to be voting on these issues. You need to be informed. And the propaganda is pretty crazy on both sides, as my team has said. So, all right, so we're doing something that is a little less controversial. Thank God. All right, here we go. Nicely done, thank you, and very timely. But I would just say just one final comment. It's kind of a bit of a crazy time, and you can see xenophobia in this country re-emerging very powerfully. And if you go back to World War II, you go back in time, it's something we need to be responsible and think about.
All right, on a lighter note, my name is Jesse Ju, and I have a question to ask you. If I ask you to name a person who has or had the greatest contribution to humanity in the past few decades, who would you name? Bill Gates of Microsoft, Steve Jobs of Apple and Pixar, Mark Zuckerberg, Jack Dorsey of Twitter, or Sal Khan from Khan Academy? Well, I stand here before you today to tell you a different person. His name is Elon Musk. While I'm not diminishing the success of these men, you might have heard of his electric car company, Tesla. And you might have seen one of these rolling around the main line, too. These are one of the handful of companies, or Tesla is one of the handful of companies he has brought to fruition. What is truly amazing is that he has managed to triumph over innumerable technological and financial challenges and keep the fledgling Silicon Valley startup afloat in the treacherous waters of the electric car industry. And to establish not only the first successful electric car company, but also an accompanying worldwide network of solar-powered charging stations to power Tesla's vehicles for free wherever they are in the world. These are all the supercharger stations in the United States. These are the supercharger stations in Asia and Australia. And these are all the supercharger stations in Europe. And there are a total of 554 supercharger stations worldwide. And he did this all in less than a decade. As Henry Ford turned the automobile from a rich man's toy into transportation for the masses, Elon is trying to do the same for electric cars. The rest of Elon's successful companies are as follows: PayPal, SpaceX, and Tesla, or SolarCity. Through these companies, he's revolutionized online banking, established the first successful space company, commercial space company, and accelerated the ubiquity of solar power in households and businesses across the United States. Currently the 100th richest man in the world with a net worth of $13 billion, Elon Musk is in command of the most innovative companies and projects around the world. SolarCity, which Elon helped found, is currently the second largest provider of solar power systems in the United States. He also has his fingers in projects like the Hyperloop, which is a tubular solar-powered high-speed transit system that may be able to carry passengers from LA to San Francisco a distance of 382 miles in roughly 35 minutes. Less than half the time it takes to fly between the two cities. The research and development for the project is currently underway. The ultimate goal of hyperloop transportation technologies is a simple, self-sustaining, cleaner and faster transit system that spans the continental United States. Also, Elon has recently requested permission from the Federal Communications Commission to launch 4,000 satellites into orbit, satellites that will provide cheap and fast internet even in places that have traditionally been deprived. If all goes to plan, satellites will be operational within 5 years. His success in business and science sectors has earned him likening to Iron Man, self-proclaimed genius billionaire, playboy, and philanthropist. Very few people, including movie enthusiasts, know that Elon Musk is actually the inspiration for Tony Stark, played by Robert Downey Jr. in the animated series. When developing the character, Robert Downey Jr. decided it would be best to meet Elon to better develop Tony Stark's character. I also think it would be better for you to meet him as well, because he's the one person alive today who has a significant impact on the future of humanity. Elon Musk was born and raised in South Africa and journeyed over to Canada and the United States for college, following the American dream, as he saw America's land with their opportunity. As Tony Stark attended MIT, majoring in physics and electrical engineering, Elon Musk received a Bachelor of Science in Physics and Economics at the University of Pennsylvania. Subsequently, he decided to pursue a PhD in applied physics at Stanford, but dropped out after 2 days and decided to capitalize on the internet boom in the 90s. And so he created Zip2, a web software company providing business directories and maps to media companies and mobile e-commerce merchants. He pocketed a cool $22 million after Comeback acquired it in 1999. He moved on to his next venture, X.com, an online financial services and email payment company, which merged with PayPal to become the online money transfer service most of us are familiar with. When eBay acquired PayPal in 2002, and pocketed an even cooler 100%. Now, if I were in this position, with millions burning a hole in my pocket, I'd probably buy 2 houses in Florida, one for my parents, and one for Dane, buy a Lamborghini for 10, and invest the rest in the wealth that's to come. But this is just where the exciting part of Elon Musk begins. To achieve his goals of making humanity a space-faring civilization, with a colony on Mars, he personally invested more than half the money he got from PayPal. It's a Space Exploration Technologies Corporation, also known as SpaceX, and ultimately ended up personally investing $145 million into the company. His reasoning? When something is important enough, you do it, even if the odds are not in favor. This quote effectively extends all of Elon's ambition to achieve the impossible. Throughout history, only four entities have put space capital into orbit and brought it back: the United States, Russia, China, and SpaceX. In 2008, Elon received a $1.6 billion contract from NASA for SpaceX to replace cargo transport function of the space shuttle. In 2012, SpaceX became the first commercial company to adopt the International Space Station and return cargo to Earth. Elon stated, "The ultimate objective is to make humanity a multi-planetary species. 30 years from now, there will be a base on the moon and on Mars, and people will be going back and forth on SpaceX rockets. And to make this economically feasible, SpaceX under Elon's careful leadership is developing a rapidly and fully reusable rocket. While the conventional space shuttle costs roughly $450 million per launch, SpaceX's Falcon 9 rocket cuts the price to $57 million. The interesting thing to know about Elon is he's both the chief executive officer and chief technology officer of SpaceX, as he essentially promised all rocket science by reading books. He's a genius. I think Ashley Vance, Elon's biographer, said it best. Mark Zuckerberg wants to help you share baby photos. Musk wants to, well, save the human race from self-imposed or accidental annihilation. Now, I'm sure you're wondering, wow, how on earth did he manage to do all this? Could it be attributed to his 100-hour working week? When Justine Musk, Elon Musk's ex-wife, was asked, will I become a billionaire if I'm determined to be one and put in the necessary work required? The answer was simple, no. However, she continued by saying, one of the many qualities that separates self-made billionaires from the rest of us is their ability to ask the right question. This is not the right question. Determination and hard work are necessary, yes, but they are the bare minimum. Shift your focus away from what you want, $1 billion, and get deeply, intensely curious about what the world wants and needs. If you're not obsessed, then stop and find whatever does obsess you. Pursue something because it fascinates you, because the pursuit itself engages and compels you. Follow your obsessions until a problem starts to emerge, a big, meaty, challenging problem that impacts as many people as possible, that you feel hell-bent to solve or die trying. It might take years to find that problem, because you have to explore the different bodies of knowledge, collect the dots, and then connect and complete them. So for Elon, it was never about the moment, but solving problems for future humanity. He asked himself, what are some of the other problems that are likely to most affect the future humanity? The answers to his questions of obtaining sustainable energy production, developing cleaner transport, and making humanities an interplanetary species, or Solar City, Tesla, and SpaceX. As Elon's founding of both Solar City and Tesla stems from an underlying motivation to help combat climate change and humanity's dangerous reliance on fossil fuels. He gave us some advice on how he innovates and noted that he implemented the first principles thinking, a physics framework in which one has to boil things down to their fundamental truths and reason up from there, as opposed to reasoning by analogy, which is just copying what other people do with slight variations. Since progress can only come by doing things differently, we must encourages us all to approach problems by first understanding them from their basic principles and then wrestling with them using all of our knowledge and determined effort to create better solutions. To help us better understand the concept, he cited two examples where first principles thinking helped him do his work. In the beginning stages of Tesla, he needed to develop cost-effective data, of which many people said it's going to cost $600 per kilowatt hour and it's not going to be much better than that in the future. But by asking questions to get at the fundamental truths, he reasoned, what are the material constituents of the batteries? What is the spot market value of these material constituents? It has carbon, nickel, aluminum, and some polymers for separation, and a steel can. Break that down on a materials basis. If we bought that on the London Metal Exchange, what would each of these things cost? Oh geez, it's only $80 per kilowatt hour. Clearly, you need to think of clever ways to make those materials and combine them with your shape of a battery cell, and you can have batteries that are much cheaper than people. The second is a similar example, in which he asked, what is a rocket made of? Aerospace-grade aluminum alloys plus some titanium, copper, and carbon fiber. And I asked, what is the value of these materials in the market? And it turned out the value of the materials cost of a rocket was around 2% of the typical price. Though these two materials are from the business and technology field, the Aristotelian first principles thinking that Elon espouses is such that we may hopefully find applicable in our lives. At the very least, both help a few of us on a business well assigned for a graded exercise for calculus. In addition, more words of wisdom, particularly for students and teachers, he advised it is important to view knowledge as a sort of a semantic tree. Make sure you understand the fundamental principles, the trunk and the big branches, before you get into the leaves or details, or else there's nothing for them to hang to. And with yet another conclusion reached by first principles thinking, Elon suggested we should aspire to increase the scope and scale of human consciousness in order to better understand what questions to ask. Really, the only thing that makes sense is to strive for greater collective enlightenment. But the single best piece of advice, in Elon's opinion, is to seek negative feedback, particularly from friends. This is something many of us personally have great difficulty doing, but it's very important to have a feedback loop where you're constantly thinking about what you've done and how you can be doing it to make it better. I think that's the single best piece of advice, is that constantly thinking about how you can do things better and question yourself. A very admirable characteristic of Elon Musk is his selflessness, his willingness to do things better for humanity, and not just for personal gains like wealth, power, or fame. Because of his noble goals, he's very selfless with regards to technological innovations as well, because he wants technology, his technology, to be ubiquitous. Recently, he opened up Tesla's patent book in June in a bid to try to foster more of a market for long-range electric cars. And when questioned about the controversial decision, he replied, "I don't care if I'm harming my competitors, I just want more electric cars." Tesla Motors was created to accelerate the advent of sustainable transport, to be clear path to the creation of compelling electric vehicles, but then lay intellectual property landmines behind us to inhibit others. We are acting in a manner contrary to that goal. Tesla will not initiate patent lawsuits against anyone who in good faith wants to use their technology. Yet another one of Elon's admirable characteristics is his ability to think on a vastly larger and different scale, never afraid to push the limit. He not only dreams of colonizing Mars, but also indicated that his ambition is to venture further out into our solar system. When asked Europa, Jupiter's 390 million miles away from Earth, attempt no landing there, she was false on Reddit's Ask Me Anything thread. He replied, "There should definitely be a science mission to Europa." Elon Musk, his companies are just as worthy of notice as Apple, Microsoft, and others, if not more. Just because we cannot see the ubiquity of his products, they encompass humanity's success as a whole. He's the one person alive today who can have the most significant impact on the future of humanity, as many of his products and prototypes of exciting products are expected to be saved in the next decade or so. You should be assured that in the future will be all the more thrilling. As Tesla has already mass manufactured high-end vehicles, beginning with Model S and Model X, he plans to release the more affordable Model 3 within 2 years. And that's supposed to cost around $30,000. I encourage you to follow him on Twitter, if you couldn't tell already. Thank you.
How many of you agree with that statement? Jesse said that one person today will have the most impact on society in the future. And he's the man who will have the most impact. Eric, what do you think? False? Agree? Disagree? Too ambitious? A little...
Yeah, I think it's a little too ambitious. I think a lot of people alive today are very influential. So I don't think we can name one single person to say that he's the most influential person on Earth. So
anybody have somebody they think is?
Well, maybe if you boil it
down. I don't know your name.
Jake. Maybe if you boil it down to transportation wise, I mean, then you can say it's most important in that field, absolutely, because you know SpaceX and Tesla are both huge and so important for our future. So. I think if you like kind of boil it down to just that air, you can apply it better, but definitely not
education. I thought it was interesting because you mentioned like Mark Zuckerberg and everyone like that and how we think they're so influential, but the quote was, they allow us to share baby photos.
Yeah.
I thought that was interesting because in some ways like they really connected like globally and humanity, but their impact is more like socially related, and Elon Musk is very like in the future, what we need to be doing, because like today, climate change, pollution is like a big issue. So I thought, like, I could definitely see him being one of those things that people just think that's such a fear right now. I think it's a possibility that he could be one of those things.
Kristen?
I think Elon Musk definitely has a strong chance of being one of those 10 million people in our lifetime. But I also think, I watched a documentary on the guy who created 5-hour energy. And I think Jesse, if you like Elon Musk, you should check him out because he's doing things very similar to what Elon Musk is trying to do. And he has a strong hand.
I agree that he definitely has the potential to be one of the most influential people in the world. I wouldn't say the most, but just comparatively, like Steve Jobs and Bill Gates, for example, one of the things that made them so successful. So impactful is not just what they were doing, but they really expanded their enterprises into humanitarian things. And I read a lot about Elon Musk, but I don't really know statistically how much he's doing as far as humanitarian things and things, ethical issues and things like that. But also like Apple, Microsoft, all those places, different things that they have, also create a lot of jobs for people, and that's one of the greatest.
Well, thank you. I hope it was interesting to Mrs. King's class and to you guys today. And my guys, two books in tomorrow. And we'll see.
I'm sorry, everybody. So many.